Everyone, Rich here in the Accu workshop, and today I'm going to be teaching you how to use calipers, tips for getting the most out of them, and finally, understanding how to read them. Whether you're measuring the diameter of a screw or the pitch between the threads, calipers offer an accuracy that's beyond what most of us can even see with the naked eye. Just as a side note, this video goes hand in hand with our latest How to Measure a Screw video, link in the description down below for that. Go check it out after this video to put your newly acquired skills to the test. So buckle up and let's break down how to use calipers like a pro. First, a quick recap. Calipers, a staple in any engineer's arsenal, are a tool of precision, versatility, and sometimes intimidation. Most often finding three flavors, digital, vernier, and dial. They let you measure incredible granularity, often down to 0.02 millimeters. They consist of two sliding scales and various types of jaws to measure the outside diameter, inside diameter, depth, and even steps on an object. Before we begin learning how to take measurements, we need to make sure that our calipers are clean from any dust or damage, paying close attention to the jaws more than anything else, as this can cause issues later on down the line. Once they're nice and clean, the next crucial step is to confirm that your caliper's zeroed. If not, any measurements you take might end up being completely inaccurate. In a nutshell, zeroing your calipers means closing it to its zero point to make sure that the measurements you take start from zero. Closing your main jaw shut should be your zero point. The reason why we clean and check for damage before this is because anything that stops your jaws from closing fully can offset your zero point. Really simple to do this on the digital caliper. Simply close the main jaws and hit the zero button next to the display. Give it a second and it should register your new zero point. For a dial caliper, you can do a similar thing where you close the jaws and then you can adjust the dial to align with the zero on the needle just like this. Lastly, with a vernier caliper, you can't actually adjust the zero point. Rather, you just need to check that when you close the jaws, the two zero points on both the sliding scales align accurately. If not, it's probably time to replace your caliper.
If only I knew somewhere where you could get a replacement.
Yes, that's right. Accu have a great selection of calipers ranging between vernier, digital and dials. When you get to the end of this video, check out the link in the description below to have a look. Let's start with measuring the outer diameter of this ball. With it being both cylindrical and threaded, it presents a great example for common mistakes to arise. So to measure outer diameter, we'll need to use the main jaws, these ones right here. Make sure to always use the correct part of the jaws. The flats right here are most commonly used, whereas the tapered ends are really only used to get in between things, like threads, for example. Now, place them around the outside of what we want you to measure. In this case, the outer diameter of the threads. Close the jaws gently and you'll get a measurement. Now, notice that I said a measurement and not the measurement. There's three pro tips that I want to mention here. Firstly, align the component perpendicular to the jaws, between 90 and 45 degrees. This makes sure that you're measuring from the widest point possible, crucial for cylinders. If you measure parallel to the jaws like this, there's a good chance that you might be misaligned and then your measurements will be off. Next, while applying slight pressure with the thumb wheel, try and give your item a little wiggle in the jaws. This will help seat it correctly. It'll also give you a tactile cue if you're accidentally caught on something, say in between threads, for example. That can also throw off your measurements. Lastly, we see this crop up a lot, especially when measuring small items. Don't use this part here on the jaws. They're not meant to be used as a measuring surface. It might sound like a lot right now, but these three tips will eventually come naturally. And don't forget, they're there to make sure that you get the most accurate results. Cool. So next we'll look at how to measure the inside diameter of an object. And for this, we'll be using these smaller jaws on top, which if you'll notice are mirrored precisely for measuring the inside diameter of items. Now, as before, follow your cleaning and zero steps to get accurate results. In this demo, we'll be measuring the inside diameter of this little flat washer right here. Very simply, carefully insert the smaller jaws into the space to be measured and begin to slide out the caliper scale until the jaws interact with the internal surfaces. Just like before, there's two key tips here to make sure you get the best results. One, try to maximize the surface area of the jaws in your item. This means to try and measure as close to the caliper body as possible, utilizing the full length of the jaws. Don't just measure using the tips. The reasoning here is that the more contact area you have can help align the angle of your calipers to get a more accurate result. Next, just like before, you can gently wiggle the item too, but this time apply slight outwards pressure using the thumb wheel so that as the object moves, the pressure helps align the jaws to the widest point. As a side note, if the pair of caliper has a locking screw, this is where it's handy. While still applying pressure, gently turn the locking screw into place. This will help lock that measurement in place and ensure it doesn't change after you release the pressure, giving you a chance to write it down once you remove it. Amazing. Next up, let's talk about how to measure depth with your calipers. For this, we'll swap to the opposite end of your calipers and make use of the sliding depth rod, this little guy right here. Now, before we take any measurements, I want to mention this little notch here at the end of the depth rod and explain what it's for. Imagine that we're measuring the depth of a hole, which at the bottom where the walls and base meet isn't exactly 90 degrees. It might have a slight fillet to it. This notch allows you space to ignore that fillet and get an accurate measurement between the walls and the base. The unnotched side also has its use. For holes that have been drilled with a traditional drill bit, the base won't be flat, it'll be conical. The right angle nature of the unnotched side allows the depth rod to slide down until the wall changes angle, and right there gives you the most accurate measurement of that hole. With that out of the way, let's measure the depth of this cross section of a hole that we've 3D printed. As always, make sure your calipers are clean and damage free before we get started. Now, as we can see, on the 3D printed jig where the walls and base meet, it's not exactly 90 degrees. There's a slight fillet to it. So we'll want to use the notch side to measure this. In a real life example, you'll want to try and visually inspect the hole to get an idea of how the walls and base meet, as well as make sure that there's no debris in there or swarf that could potentially skew your measurement. First, we want to position the caliper over the hole, making sure that the base of the caliper is as flush as it can be to the surface of the material. Now extend the depth rod down until it reaches the bottom of the hole. My main tip to remember here is to make sure that the caliper remains flush at the top and that the depth rod is parallel to the walls to avoid any angular errors. Once it stops, you can either take the measurement there and then, or again, use the locking thumb screw to lock the caliper in place and then remove the rod from the hole, taking down your measurement. This is really handy if you're working on a bigger workpiece and need to return to a work area to write the measurement down, such as a desk or maybe a laptop. Last but not least, we can use our caliper to measure the step on a workpiece. For this, we'll be using the very back of the caliper. Often incorrectly used, this little ridge here that appears once your calipers are extended allows your caliper to square up to a 90 degree step and measure up to another 90 degree step. For illustration, we'll use this little 90 degree right angle bracket. Now as always, and I know I'm repeating myself, make sure to clean and zero your calipers, as you'll need to begin with your calipers open just slightly like this. Now, rest the top edge of the lower sliding scale up to the first step and allow the side of the upper main scale to rest on top of the step, almost creating an interlocking 90 degree shape. Now, slide out the caliper until the top of the main scale touches the next step and you'll get your measurement. My main tip here is to be aware of the alignment on every side. There's lots of little 90 degree angles at play, and if any of them are out, so too will be your measurement. Try to view the measurement that you're taking from the side on, as well as from above and below, just to double check that you're square, and then take down your measurement. Okay, so now we've learned how and where to position the jaws of our calipers on multiple items to get a reading. If you've got a dial or digital caliper, you're ready to set forth on your measuring journey. If you've got a vernier caliper, however, interpreting the vernier scale is a skill in itself. Let's go over that now. The first thing to remember is that you have two scales to measure from, the main scale and the vernier scale. Once you're in the right position to take a measurement, you'll need to take a pre-decimal and a post-decimal reading. For the pre-decimal reading, you need to read the last visible mark on the main scale that the zero line on the vernier scale has passed. So in this example, we've got 3 millimeters. Next, for the post-decimal reading, you need to find the line on the vernier scale that matches up exactly with a line on the main scale. These should look exactly vertical. In our example here, we can see 9, but remember, these are in a scale of each mark on the vernier scale being 0.02 millimeters. So 9 here is actually 0.9 millimeters. So to get to our total reading on this vernier caliper, we'd be adding our pre-decimal reading of 3 millimeters and our post-decimal reading of 0.9 millimeters together, giving us 3.9 millimeters. Alongside all of the other tips that we've given you throughout this video, one key tip for reading a vernier caliper is to be aware of parallax shift. This is where, if you view your caliper from an angle, it can actually make the lines on the vernier scale that are supposed to match up between both scales shift, meaning you'll read a different measurement depending on if you're reading it from straight on or to the side. Another tip here is to make use of the locking thumb screw and read your vernier while it's flat on a desk. So go ahead and take your measurement, lock it in place, and take it somewhere that you can definitely read that caliper dead on. The last thing to mention here is that not all vernier calipers measure down to 0.02 millimeters. Some measure in 0.05 millimeter increments, and this can indicate the accuracy for what the caliper can measure down to. Now, before we wrap up, I want to answer one burning question that I know you'll all be wanting the answer to. What's the best type of caliper? Now, personally, I love digital. They're so easy to use, zero, and get an accurate reading from that they're my go-to. That said, they do have one huge flaw, which is that when the battery dies, they're no longer really useful. I usually keep a couple of spare batteries in my toolbox for this reason alone, but I appreciate that it can be a bit of a deal breaker depending on your industry. As for vernier calipers, I can see how purists love the analog nature. Not needing batteries is also a big win, and if you're dealing with sensitive equipment, you might have no choice but to use a vernier. However, when it comes time to reading and interpreting the scale on a vernier, it's a bit of a faff until you're used to using them. As for dial, I think they sit nicely in between vernier and digital. They have a neat dial interface that does make reading easier than a vernier scale, and they also have the benefit of not needing batteries. Plus, they have an adjustable 0.2. All calipers, vernier, dial, and digital are accurate enough to the point where if you need additional accuracy, a caliper might not be the best tool for you. You might then need to be looking at a micrometer. Food for thought. So there we have it. If you've watched this video all the way through, you should now be a caliper connoisseur. All that's left to do is put your theory into practice. As always, don't forget to like the video if you learned something and subscribe for more engineering guides. If there's anything you want to see, drop us a comment down below and let us know. Thanks for watching. Catch you in the next one.